Hello, everyone. Welcome to another Mix Tank Live. My name is Mark Abrams, and I'm here with Puremix.com for another Mix Tank. So Mix Tank is our mix commenting platform on Puremix.com, where you can upload your mixes and other Puremix community members can comment on them and leave tips and things that they hear that might help out with your journey to the perfect mix, which doesn't exist. Before we get started, I'd like to do a little bit of housekeeping. Thank you to everybody who came to the live stream and the mixing contest wrap-up last Friday featuring David Bendith. We had David, we had The Warning, and we had Rick Beato show up. That was insane. And congratulations again to the winners. The first place winner was The Hunter. Second place was JBev. And third place was MFrats. Those are all their Puremix usernames. So if you see them around in the community on Mixtank or whatever, reach out and say congrats, because that's pretty amazing. We had over 300 mixes submitted for that thing, and to rise to the top of that is just amazing. Congrats to everybody who submitted a mix. That just completing one and putting it out there for the world to hear is achievement in itself. So great job to everybody, and congrats to all the other top 10 listeners. If you missed that live stream, that's available on YouTube, and you can watch David and Rick comment on the top 10 mixes as they listen to them from start to finish, which is really, really cool. And the band as well. You can hear how the band reacted to hearing 10 different mixes of their song. So pretty cool. Welcome everybody. So pretty cool. The chat room's filling in. Awesome. So how we're going to do this, guys, I like to prioritize everybody who shows up to the stream live. So if you're here and you submitted a mix for today, let me know in the comments, drop your username and the name of your track, and I'll get to it. You'll notice our chat looks a little bit different over here today. There was some weird stuff going on, but it's fine. We can see what you're saying. So there you go. Also, make sure that you comment on the mixes as I play them down too, because your feedback is just as useful. And this is a community effort. So let's dig in and listen to some music. So first up, I've got at the very top, we've got Jose. And the song is Agua de Beber. Sorry for butchering that pronunciation. Here we go. Let's check it out. Awesome, Jose. That's a great track. Very cool. Amazing musicians on that too, guys. That's insane. The level of talent here never ceases to amaze. It's awesome. We had a question from Ja Warrior asking how to submit a mix. So to submit a mix, you have to be a Puremix member. You go to puremix.com and then you'll click on Mix Tank up at the top menu bar. And then there's this button up here for submit a mix. So you'll click on that and then there's some information and all that jazz. So you can put your mix in. So there we go. That's how you submit a mix for this. Okay. So let me get Jose's track back up here. It was right there. It was right there. Come on. There we go. Okay. Cool. So yeah, great job on this track. Sounds amazing. The playing's amazing and all that jazz. I have very little to comment about on this. One, I love the mono piano that's over on the right. I love mono point sources, and piano is one of those things that everybody does in stereo all the time, but it works really well in mono, and it can be such a cool harmonic thing to have as just like a point source that's happening in a specific area. So that's really cool. I love the intentionality there. My biggest comment is probably automation overall, just doing automation to breathe some life into the mix. To start with that, like the first thing I noticed is obviously the percussion is on top and forward of everybody else. Now, I know that that's very much the style of the music, and percussion is like almost like the lead vocal in this kind of music sometimes. So that's a taste and a genre specific thing. However, I noticed that anytime there's a solo, the solo is always kind of happening behind the percussion. So if you think about depth front to back in the stereo field, the percussion's kind of up here, and then the solos are kind of happening back here. And that's to do both with volume and the brightness of the percussion as well. Again, not that there's anything wrong with the percussion and stylistic choice. You may choose to just leave the percussion on top of everybody the entire time. But I was thinking it might be nice if on those solo sections, if you did some automation, either to just bring the solo forward or to, you know, you could pull the percussion back while you push the solo forward as well. And then two, as long as the percussion is so much brighter than the rest of the instruments, it's always going to seem like it's leaning forward. So if we thought of our speaker like this and this being forward, like leaning forward, so almost like the speaker's here, but then the sound is kind of doing one of these where it's like leaning forward and pointing out of the speakers a little bit in this like coming forward at you kind of way. I have some incredible hand motions on here. Again, this is a bat, which is pretty cool. As long as the percussion's brighter than everything else, it's going to seem like it's closer and a little bit more present than everybody else too. So I would experiment with just like having some fun with it. If you have some faders, this is much easier. Any kind of control surface. I personally don't want to mix without a control surface or faders of some sort, because it's just not possible for me to do things like reach over, grab the percussion, pull it back while I'm pushing up the guitar solo or the sax solo or whatever, and then ride to those faders. That allows you to do a bit of a performance. And if you want some inspiration on that, check out Michael Brower's video on the site. Both where he's mixing at the end on his S1s and where he just talks about putting himself into the mix and it being a performance and falling in love with what the message of the song is, trying to put himself in that place and then perform that and make that all come to life through the instrument that he has or that you have, your mixing console and the tools that you have. So, other than that, I think that there's some EQ things that could be done, like on the more DI'd sounding acoustic, it could use some point and come forward as well. So just things about like, where do you want the spotlight to go on the mix? Where I think that you're at right now with this mix is like, you've done a wonderful job of setting it up tonally. You've got a good balance going on for like a static mix. Now just put some life into it and do a little bit of a performance on it. I hope that helps. Great job. And this is a super cool song. All right, on to the next one. Let's see if I'm missing anybody here. Okay, so let's go on to Mike Orensby. Mike, I've got speakers around me. Look, I got speakers. There's speakers above me. They're around me. This is amazing. The Atmos thing is almost done, so I'm excited about that. But I say that because Mike always makes super Atmos sounding mixes in stereo, which is super cool. So, okay. Guys, as a reminder, if you're just joining us and you have a song up on Mixtank that you'd like me to review, drop your username and the name of the song in the chat and we'll get to it. All right, next up is Studio Jaman. Let me find the song. Here we go. Let's put it in HD because that's what we do. Here we go. Awesome. I want to go back and listen to one section again. That was super cool. Here we go. Awesome. Very cool, Mike. It's amazing to me. Every time that you come on, you have like a different style of music, and it's always like, it's always great too, which is really cool. So yeah, this is super awesome. Great job on the surf guitars too, because that's a very specific tone that you have to be very aware of that music and really going for that to like do it well. And I think that you've nailed it here. The thing that's tricky about surf guitar stuff is those upper mids, like, and when I say upper mids, I'm thinking like the 2.9, 3K-ish region. There's always a little bit of a spike in there that's really hard to deal with, because if you go to compress it, it doesn't really just catch that one range, even if you get like super dialed in with a sidechain compressor, which I recommend the Pulsar 78 that comes with the Puremix subscription suite. That sounds like I'm just, you know, schlucking that particular plugin, but that one you can get really dialed in with on the sidechain. FabFilter Pro C2 as well. But anyway, also a de-esser can work for this thing, but it's really hard to get that right. So in this one, that specific range, like right where the pick happens, that's one, a super important part of that guitar tone, and two, can be painful. So on this mix, it's a little pokey to me. I don't know, like, it's not necessarily a thing that you have to smooth out because it's also part of the style, but that's something like if I had the tracks up in front of me, I would try to make that a little bit smoother without stealing the life and the aggression from it too, because again, like, as you know, because you got that tone so well, that's a super important part of it. There's a bit of a low mid thing going on. I agree, one, with, as I pretty much always do, with everything that Tom put in the track as well about the low mids of the guitar. I also think that there's something in the kick that's causing a little bit of like low mid fuzziness, I guess, like blurriness, where the picture is just becoming a little bit blurry. There's something in there that's like overtone that's not necessarily a part of the note length, but just kind of clouding the image. And I think that that's also happening like in that, you know, like 160 to 240 ish kind of range in there. Like if there was a little bit of cleanup, I think that that might open up the picture a little bit. So that's pretty much all I got on this mix. I think it's awesome. And as always, it's nice and feels immersive and all of that. It's funny that I noticed the G-Wiz put on here. I'd like to hear you do this work on a real immersive rig in 7.4.2 and all that. So that's pretty cool. And then you said you're going to do 7.1.4, which is awesome. Cool. Yeah, I hope that that's useful. I think that you did a great job on this, honestly. And there's like a couple little cleanup things. And then like, what else do you do? It sounds great. Awesome. Cool. Mike Conway wants to hear more Spring Verb. Spring Verb is always great. Awesome. Palisades, I see you. Awesome. You got a track. Cool. So guys, if you're here and you have a track, make sure you put it in the chat. I'm going up to see who else I got here. We're going to do Gord next. And Gord's track is called Walking Down My Street. All right, here we go. This is version 3. And Jaw Warrior, I'm going to, I'll do an exception on this one. So I'll check out your track, but we're going to do it. I have to do it after we do all the members first. So if we have time at the end, we'll pull up your track and you can email me that Dropbox link. Okay. Walking Down My Street from Gord. Here we go.
Baby, I've been waiting on this point for you all my life. Trying not to cry, cry, cry. Cause I know it's a long, long time before you walk down my street, yeah, brighten up my street, walk down this street to me, yeah. I don't live in a part of town where you lay your wealth out on display, trying not. Down this street to me.
Awesome job, Gord. That's great. Very, very cool. I haven't heard the earlier versions of this, but seems like you're on the right track, judging by like the notes and some comments from Tom there. So once again, I agree with Tom's comments. Some comments on the drum specifically that I had. So I thought he was right about like watching out for the ghost note stuff in programmed drums, definitely. So if you hear anything that to your ear starts to sound unnatural, just stop and do some automation or do something to those particular parts to make it feel a little bit better. The main thing that pops out to me, there's two things. So one, the drums are super, super loud to me for this genre. Their importance in the mix is a little bit overstated, in my opinion. So I like the lyrics of this song a lot, and like the story grabbed me when, you know, I kind of like was honed in on the sound of the drums at first and listening for all the mix things. And then about halfway through the song, after like I felt like I found the things in the mix that are grabbing my ear. And then I started like hearing more of the lyric and I got pulled into the story and I was like, this is a great story. I wish that I was more focused on the lyrics from the beginning. And that just tells me, okay, there's stuff about the mix in the beginning that's keeping me away from the story of the song and the lyric. So as I'm kind of a broken record on these things, like who's the important person that we need to put the spotlight on? And that to me is the vocals, especially when it's great songwriting like this and the lyric, the vocal has to be front and center. So I would consider like how the balance of the mix is going right with that stuff. So right now I feel like there's a lot of emphasis on making everything sound great, which of course is the point of doing a mix and everything. But then it's now that you kind of have your tones, there's kind of a couple different ways to approach it. Like a lot of times in a mix, I'll go through and I'll get my sounds on everything. I'll get a general balance working. And then you can either go through the console and zero out all the faders and you're like, cool, I got the tones. Now let me try and put everything, you know, together at a good balance and figure out what's the song talking about and all that. Or you could say like, I've got my tones and I've got my balance. Now let me zoom out a little bit. What's the song about? What's the person talking about? What's the emotion of the song? Is it sad? If it's sad, having hyped up drums or hyped up everything that sounds super clear and bright and all of that might not be the right direction tonally for the song. So obviously these are questions you should ask before you get the tones too, but you know, figure out like what's the lyric, what's supposed to be happening, who are the stars of the production too, like who's keeping the groove going, who's helping to, you know, propel the story forward. So with those thoughts in mind, the drums to me, I know like you're working off of VST and everything and you're working, it sounds really hard, trying to get the program drums to sound less polished and give them more room sound to help them fit in with your performance style. So I think it's more than just like EQ and balancing on this. I would actually choose some different samples for this style of music. Right now, the drum kit sounds very modern to me. And while it sounds like a really good drum kit, it doesn't really sound like a singer-songwriter drum kit to me. It sounds like somebody brought in like the brand new DW kit that they bought at Sweetwater or Guitar Center or something. They brought that over to the session and they had just gotten done playing with a rock band and they have like a really snappy beater tone going on it and like the toms are, you know, a bit scooped and all that. And they came onto your session to play drums and it was just the wrong guy for the gig. Or whatever, you know, like the playing's good, but or the programming playing is good, but they needed to have a different drum kit that more fit your style for it. So I would look for some different samples, and in order to do this, you're programming the drums, so you're working off of VST. What you could do is print each one of the drums, each track, so like you have a kick, snare, just like a traditional drum set, and then go through and use like Drum Replacer, which you have in your Puremix account. And find some samples of like some old Gretsch kit or something a little bit more vibey. There's some really good ones out there. I'm like failing to think of something right now, but maybe chat room, you can help me out and let us know where you could find some great drum samples for this kind of music. But there's really, really good stuff out there. I think Reed Shippen had a drum pack that was out at some point for free. You could Google. And he had some stuff in there that was kind of Beatles-y sounding and not necessarily like old and 50s sounding, but just had a little bit more of like that that singer-songwriter kit sound. So yeah, that's some stuff. And if you don't want to do that or you can't do that, but you would like to, you know, demodernize the drum kit a little bit, just try putting some mids back in the drums and taking some of the attack down. I think both those things would help. And then from there, I would go through and in each section of the song, just say, who's the star? Who's the star here? And put that person out front and on top. Right where it's at right now, it sounds like you've been working on the drums, and it sounds a little bit like a drum cover video where the drums are the star of the song. So hope that that helps. Great song, and great performances in there too. I think like that's super close. It's just a couple fun things. And then, you know, like I was saying on the last one too, go through and like put some of yourself in there, feel the song, lose the whole mixing part of this whole thing, and just perform. Just mix the song like from an emotional place instead of from a technical one. Hope that that helps. The tambourine felt a little bit like it was poking out to me. That might be one other thing to look at. And then I love the vocal when you panned it right. That was really cool too. So awesome, Gord. Thank you for submitting. Hope that's help or that's helpful. Neil says, there didn't feel like there was a lot of movement from start to finish. So yeah, that's where the automation stuff can really dig in and make it sound fun. Smoking Fudo, good to see you. Hey, Martin, good to see you. Jeff, good to see you guys. This is awesome. We've been off for 2 weeks, so it's great to see everybody back. Very cool. We were getting ready for that live stream last week and had some other technical stuff pop up. We couldn't do Mixtank because we were doing the mixing contest, which took over Mixtank. So that was a whole thing. But we're back. Okay, so our next one is Mike Conway, Blind Love. Let's do it. And where's my thing? There we go. Blind Love. Boom. Okay, here we go.
Show a poor man the some reality. When what he sees ain't what he believes. Lay the facts out so there's no dispute. But still he's sticking to his gospel truth. I was so blind, but now I see. Shame on you, shame on me. Take a woman going man to man, 'cause none of them dudes ever fit her plan. They're just stops along the way who think today's their lucky. I was so blind, but now I see. Shame on you, shame on me. Help a blind man,
help a blind man.
Help a blind man. Help a blind man.
Help a blind man.
Help a blind man.
Help a blind man.
It's not the way I sold my dignity. It's how cheap it turned out. It must have run away when I saw you looking back my way. I'm guilty of blind love, blind, blind love. Shame on you, shame.
have a blind man.
Yeah.
Can you help me? Help a blind man.
Yeah.
I'm so blind. Can you help me? Help a blind man. I'm so blind I can't see nothing. Nothing at all. Every time you call, I come running back. I can't stop myself. Every time you call, I can't see nothing at all. Every time you call, I'm so blind I can't stop myself. Somebody help me, help me, help me, help me stop myself. Help a blind man, yeah. Can you help me now? Help a blind man.
Awesome, Mike. Thank you for submitting. That's a great tune. So you said on there, first time with all the parts in, lots to sort out. Did you produce this? Because it's super good. Love the song. Very cool. So my first thing is that the mix sounds too loud, just overcompressed, and I'm pretty sure I'm hearing a limiter that's biting down pretty hard and like definitely lopping the snare off of it. And I feel like you've done some pretty good work to try and make everything sit in the pocket well. You mentioned that there's still some editing to do on the horns. You'll get to that. No worries. Awesome, cool. Just reading some of the comments. So overall, it feels a little compressed. If you have a limiter on there or whatever you're doing to get the volume out of it, I would, if you're going to do another pass of this, I'd just take that off. And just leave it off until the end. Or this could have been a thing where you put it on at the end. Actually, let us know in the chat if you added the limiter at the end of your mix or if you mixed into it. This feels like it could have been added on the end because I'm just curious. I got ding for that in the comments. We'll fix. Nice. If it was added on at the end, you might have just done some volume stuff and not really been paying too close attention to what was going on with the mix. You were just trying to get it up to a level where you could go and listen to it somewhere else. So that can easily happen. I would try, if you were mixing into it or whatever, if you were mixing into it, take it off, and then you're probably going to have to do some balancing to fix what falls apart from it because it's doing a lot of work here. Tom commented on what it's doing to the bottom of the mix. I agree with that. I also think it's making the, so first of all, it's choking the snare, which I think is very important in the song. The backbeat's really important because you have such a groove going with all the instruments and you've got some good players on here and you've done some timing work and all of that stuff. I feel like losing the backbeat is hurting the groove of the song. So the limiter is messing up our groove. Then the other thing that happens, became apparent to me next is that the bass guitar is taking up all of the bottom of the mix. So it's overshadowing the kick drum. So I'm getting like kick, the kick is all snap and no bottom punch. And then the bass is just kind of like a lot of sub information, just kind of, you know, rumbling around down there. There's good note definition on the bass, but then the bottom of it is just kind of murky and slugging around a little bit to me, and eating the bottom of the kick. So I think a little bit more low-end punch from the kick would be nice, and then a little bit of, you know, high-pass filter on the bass guitar would help make some room for the kick to punch a little bit. The vocal is overcompressed to me, and the BGVs are a little overcompressed. The super low voice that comes in has a lot of mid-range or upper mids, like 2K-ish kind of thing coming out that's making them a little harsh. So I just, you know, maybe back off compression on those and then see what happens. But all of that could be tied into whatever's happening on the mix bus at the end of it. So I think that you know what to do. Awesome. Oh, okay, so you say that you mixed into a limiter at the end. Yeah, so like it's totally totally a thing that's, for me, I'm speaking for myself, it's easy to do when I slap a limiter on at the end and I'm just like kind of going for level. Sometimes I'll not hear the nuance of what's going on, especially if I'm just working quickly. Like it happens to me on tracking mixes where like we're at the end of a 12-hour day and like everybody wants to listen to it again on the way home for some reason, even though they've heard it 5,000 times, and they're like, give us a quick balance and then make sure it's at a good volume. So like I'll, you know, do a quick balance and then slap a limiter on there, and then I'm driving home and I'm like, Jesus, the limiter, you know, or whatever. So easy to do, but anyway, hope that that's useful Cool. Juan, I see you. We'll get to your mix. Absolutely. Cool. Palisades, I saw you. We'll get to that one as well. And yeah, thank you again for submitting that, Mike. I hope that's of some help. All right, let's see what we're doing next. We're going to do Tony's mix of money from the mixing contest. This will be cool. Awesome. Okay, so Tony Salazzo. So he says, hopefully this request, no, not in bad taste or inappropriate at all. Let's do it. I would appreciate a review of this mix of money to help me learn how to get better. Cheers, Tony. Okay, sweet. Let's check it out. So this is money from The Warning. Here we go. Awesome. Nice job, Tony. Thanks for submitting. So let's chat about it a little bit. So one of the things with getting a mix from somebody else or mixing something that you haven't produced is there's some intentionality that's baked into the multi-track, right? So the artist has a direction that they've been going down, hopefully, and some of that is obvious. And then sometimes it's not obvious and you have to give them a call or make sure that you have a conversation about it. But one of the things like that I have to watch out for when I get files online with people that I haven't worked with, I wasn't part of the production team, but I have to make sure that I'm honoring the original vision of that thing. So what I'm hearing in this mix of it is that it's a bit... it's heavily processed and a bit wildly different from the multi-track. So the all of the sounds are explosive and powerful by themselves, but then as a collective whole, they don't allow the song to poke through. So again, like I keep going back to the song thing, but so for example, like the kick is very explosive and blown up and powerful and pushed and all of that. But it's also really on top of the mix and it's overshadowing the vocals. The vocals have a lot of processing on them in that they're a little bit too de-essed. The EQ is pretty drastic on them. They're very smooth and not aggressive like the song is. So there's not a lot of like transient punch coming from them. So they might've been overcompressed. And then they're also sitting back in the mix. So when I say back in the mix, you could call that volume low or like, you know, low, loud, quiet, soft or whatever. But I always think of it in terms of front to back. If something is louder, it's closer to me. If it's quieter, it's further away. And in this mix, the vocals are back here while the kick drum is up here. And if you think about the importance of each element inside of the mix, you probably wouldn't say that the kick drum is quite as important as being way out here. Now, in a rock mix like this, you might feel that it's, you know, important where it's almost side by side with the vocal or just a little bit behind, or maybe even with the vocal if it's, you know, really modern rock, but where it's the superstar is probably not the intent of the production, I guess. The mix feels a little overcompressed overall. And I think basically what might've happened here is you were going for great sounds on everything. And then it was less about the balance of the song or finding the importance of each element inside of the mix. Where do they all fit together in order to highlight the thing that's important, which is always to me, the vocal, even on a song like this. You might have things be a little bit more blown up in a song like this, but it's to me still the vocal. Where this mix might go wrong with a band is if you sent it to them and it was wildly different from the production, it takes them a second to get over that feeling. So the initial reaction is never, oh my God, what an amazing thing you've done to our song. They're like, whoa, what's going on? I'm not used to this. This feels weird. Is it cool? I don't know yet. I'm feeling a little out of the water or whatever. So, yeah. So in terms of like getting into, a top 10 on a mixing contest like this, right from the bat, I think if we listen to the very beginning of it. I actually love the treatment that you did on it. So never mind, I'm going to skip that comment. What I do want to say is on one of my favorite mixing contests that we've done was with Joe Ciccarelli mixing Alanis Morissette. And he was also, just like David Bendith was the producer on this song and the mixer, Joe was the producer and the mixer on Alanis' song. And one of the comments that Joe had was he wished that the mixes that were submitted from the contest went somewhere new that he didn't go. So that totally fights with everything that I just said, right? Because he, as a producer, was thinking like, this is great. I'm having, you know, my song that I produced put on Puremix. There's going to be 300 plus mixes submitted to this thing. And I'm going to hear some really cool different takes on the song that I produced. And what he said on the wrap-up live stream was he was disappointed because he felt like everybody was trying to get to either reproduce the mix that he did, or you know, like they weren't really trying any new angles with it. It was mostly just trying to match what he did and replicate that. And he wanted to hear some new takes on the thing. So that totally fights against what I said with your mix, Tony. But I do feel like the individual elements didn't help to push the song forward, which I think is what the important thing is. I don't mean this as a knock to you, Tony, but I think like a general comment that I've been thinking about, because I saw this quote from Alan Parsons over the weekend, and the quote was, hopefully I don't mess this up, he said, audiophiles don't listen to your music on their equipment. They use your music to listen to their equipment. So one more time, that's audiophiles don't listen to your music on their equipment. They use your music to listen to their equipment. And I think that sometimes as mixers, we're guilty of using the song or the material to play with our toys, right? To play with our plugins, to like find out what happens with this compressor and, oh, does this EQ sound sweeter than this other one? And we very quickly can lose focus on what's important, which is the music. Like, it seems like an obvious thing, and maybe I'm the only one who feels this way or whatever, not to like speak for everybody in the chat or whatever, but that really jumped out to me as a quote, like when I think I saw it on Instagram or something like that. But I just paused and I was like, man, we do the same thing in mixing sometimes where we just aren't paying attention to what the songwriter is trying to say. We're just like, does this blue stripe sound cooler than the black one on the vocal? Like, who cares? What's the song about? You know, so that kind of stuff. So I hope that that's helpful, Tony. I think that like you're on a great track with this thing, and I would encourage you to like do another pass at it. The song's only a minute and 20. The stems were truncated down to a minute and 20 for copyright and all that. So if you can do another copy on it and, or do another pass on it, and just think about as you go into it, like who's driving the song? What's the story? What's the vocal doing? That doesn't mean just put the vocal on top of everything, but it means like try to get into the song and do a performance off of what you're feeling from it. And don't worry too much about, is this a great mix? Hope that that helps. Funny thing for somebody to say on a mixing thing. Is this a great mix? Who's worried about that? Okay, awesome. So Tony, you said in the chat, that's interesting. Most of those things that you mentioned were deliberate choices. Maybe I need to make better choices balance-wise. So deliberate choices are awesome. And with the thing like over-DSing a vocal, that can very much be a listening environment situation, right? So I don't know if you're on headphones or what your monitors are like. For that kind of thing, it's really useful to also check against references. So listen to your vocal and then listen to the released version of the song, since you have the luxury of that with this one. Listen to the top end of the vocal, and maybe theirs is too S-y for you, and you did do that, and that's why you went your direction or whatever. But yeah, just play with it and find other references that you like a lot too. References where you think the vocal balance is great, and it's not too S-y, and it doesn't sound like it has a slight lisp or whatever. So, yeah, hope that that helps. Okay. Cool. Let's go on to another. One says, Mark, want to hear the best mix of Jealousy ever made? I do, and we're going to listen to it. Let me see if we're going to listen to it next. Awesome. Tony, thank you so much for submitting. I hope it's useful. Everybody, my email is mark@puremix.net. Sometimes I'm slow to get back, but if you email me, I will get back to you eventually. I promise. If you want to chat more about it. I put my phone number on here. I'd say that, but I get way too many robocalls as it is. And I'm sure they're crawling the transcripts now. So, okay, let's hit... Very sorry, guys. I'm just searching for the next one here. We're going to hit... Tortilla Man says his cat is very hungry. It's important. We did Blind Love. We did that one. We did Walking Down My Street. I think our next one is going to be Palisades. Let's do it. Can't Shake. All right. Tony, if you do another mix of that, that'd be super cool. We're back on Mix Tank in 2 weeks, so we could check it out again then, too, if you wanted to submit it in 2 weeks. So, okay, here we go.
I know I shouldn't be calling you right now, but I just needed to hear your voice. Come meet me at the spot.
I can't shake.
I know I shouldn't be calling you right now.
Palisades, who did you call to get the Decepticons to do a feature on your track? That's insane. You got the freaking Decepticons to do a feature on your track. I want to listen to it again.
You know where to find me.
Is it a
Amazing. Do you owe Michael Bay royalties for that? That was super cool. I love it, man. Great job. One thing I noticed from your previous tracks is that you got the vocal samples working in this one better than I've heard in the other ones, in a clarity sense. So whether or not that was, you know, completely deliberate on the last ones, totally, you know, taste choice, but on this one, I feel like I'm not struggling to hear them, which is really cool. And I feel like the overall balance is great on this. It doesn't feel as squashed as some of the stuff in the past has either. So I feel like there's a lot of progress happening here on your mixes, Palisades, which is awesome. And thank you for submitting another one. It's awesome to see people come back and like do more mixes. And we've been doing these for months now, and it's just cool to see everybody's progression. Also, again, the talent on here is insane. And I don't mean the Decepticons, I mean you. Palisades for producing this, although the Decepticons did a great job on it as well. Okay, sweet. So the reading through your comments on the right, here's a new one in the works. I'm experimenting quite a bit with the arrangement. It has different parts that expand outside the box. So I definitely appreciate feedback on the cohesiveness and general thoughts on the listener's perspective on arrangement. Next, I have four bass sub layers, and then you talk about how you make the sub layers. And that you vary them throughout the song, depending on the section, and along with the call and response guitar bits. You'd appreciate feedback on the bass sound design. Finally, and as usual, you appreciate the mixing advice. Okay, so the one thing that I had to say was around 50 seconds, right when your first big bass, I think, comes in, which is here. So again, like in terms of importance with level and all of that, and where you place each element in the mix, the guitar sounding thing that's happening, doing the melodic line there, that feels really quiet while you have a bass sound that's really wide. There's a little bit of stereo spread stuff happening on it, and it's very loud. So the listener is being told, again, this is the most important thing to listen to. But from a harmonic enjoyment standpoint, our ears like melody too, right? Like, so this is my opinion, but I would definitely raise the melodic element up to a point. You could leave the bass where it is because you're obviously trying to shake the room with the bass, but I would bring the melodic element up there to let the ear latch onto that. So that's going from like the listener point of view. What does the listener want to hear? What's enjoyable to them? Like, obviously the big bass is going to be super fun. That's a lot of the reason that people, you know, enjoy this kind of music. Is the freaking Michael Bayness of it. But I do think that like some of the melodic elements could come up a little bit. Your sound effects, the whooshes, the things flying around and all of that sounds amazing. And I had to make sure my Atmos speakers weren't on. Not really, but it's awesome. It sounds really, really good. The only other thing I had on there was like the kick. I felt like the kick could use a little bit more snap or punch. And mostly probably because of your comments too. And because of the importance, like where you have the bass in the mix, I feel like you're really focused on making that bass sound great. And if this is a tracking mix, like you're still in production, totally makes sense that the bass is a little bit loud right now. I feel like you as the producer are really honing in on that bass and making that the most important thing to you. But I wonder if it is the most important thing for the overall arrangement. So, my taste is that it's a little loud right now. The other elements need to shine a little bit more, but you're also going for a thing. I don't think you're done with the mix yet. That kind of stuff all counters into there. But in terms of the sound design, I thought it was awesome. I think it's great that you're doing all of those layers as long as you're doing them for reasons like, you know, I need to hear more mid here, or I want to change the bass feel here. As long as those are all not for the sake of like, how fancy can I get with my sound design, but they're for the sake of like, I want it to do this either from a sound design perspective or from a mixing perspective. then that's great. So just making sure that the intention's in the right spot. So very cool. I hope that that helps. Amazing. Cool. Okay. Let's go on to our next one here. And I hope that was super useful. I didn't get to do my strobes today. I'm sorry. We'll do it next time. Okay. We did chords already. Let's do You Don't Call Me No More. Let's see. This is from Keith Warman. Here we go.
Ooh, don't you call me no more. You and I are through. No more hugging and kissing.
Awesome, Keith. Great job. Yeah, this is sounding super cool. There's a couple things I want to listen to again. First one is just at the very top here. Here we go.
Ooh, don't you call me no more.
So, okay. So one thing that I've been thinking about lately and noticing a lot is a lot of times you can tell the general tonality of a mix from the first, I don't know, like 5-10 seconds, you know how good a mix is going to be for the rest of it. And at least in general, right? Like things obviously change. You can have a song like you get from Palisades where like it takes a left turn, not that your last one did, but it can take a left turn somewhere and it'd be a totally different thing. And that's happened here on the show a lot too. Thing about this, the reason that I say that, well, first of all, one more thing on that note. So on the thought of like, you can tell what a mix sounds like in the first, you know, 10, 15 seconds or whatever. Our ears work like that with transients as well, right? Like from the first couple, like, I think it's like 10 milliseconds or something. I don't remember the exact number, but from the first very onset of the song, the transient tells us what a sound sounds like. And our ear identifies, like, that's a snare drum, or that's a kick drum, or whatever. That's a gunshot. That's a lion, whatever it is. We can tell very, very, very quickly. So same thing can happen from a mix. Now, what happens here is this first opening guitar, I'll play it one more time.
Call me no more. You and I.
So it's reverberant, it's in the background, but there's a lot of low end information on it. Like, so there's a lot of lows that's kind of swamping around on it, which a lot of low information doesn't give the perspective of depth. So first comment on that is, if you want that opening guitar line to see like it's, you know, far away from us and verbed out a little bit, you're going to have to high pass some of that low end, and it should feel like that guitar just falls back in the mix a bit. A lot of that is if you think about like how close or like how somebody's voice sounds to you when they're talking close to you versus further away. There's more low end, there's more presence. You probably hear a little bit more top end. They back up, things thin out a little bit and become more mid-range focused, that kind of thing. It's a really fun thing to do at parties if you lose track of what the person's saying. You just focus on, like, what does their voice sound like? Whatever. So anyway, it can be very distracting. But in this particular case, we've got reverb, distant guitar, and then the vocal and drums and everything kick in with a completely different tonality and a different sense of dryness. So everybody's much more close up. So listen to the transition that happens here.
Ooh, don't you call me no more. You and I are through.
So for me, instead of that intro being like this really cool sonic thing that happens, it's confusing to me when the rest of the band comes in. I'm like sort of disoriented, like I have to readjust my expectations of what the song's going to be like, because it's such a contrasting difference, and there's not really a whole lot of like transition from the distant reverb thing to the close uptight thing. I know you're going for a moment there, and I think that's awesome, but keep tweaking on it a little bit and see if you can smooth it out if you were just mixing for me, which you're not. So, you know, do what you like, but that's something I would look at. Okay, the next thing I wanted to check out was the amazing snare verb that you have going on at 145. So here we go. Okay, so I think that there's some automation going on here where you're bringing the snare up during that guitar solo section. The thing that happens to me is the drums come forward while the guitar player is playing the solo, and he's kind of in the background while the drummer is getting some and going to town with that super awesome sounding snare verb. So it almost sounds to me like you were working on the snare verb, you got it sounding awesome, and then you moved on to something else in the mix and you forgot to bring the snare back into the mix and let the guitar solo come back up. Because again, like the spotlight should be on the guitar player at that moment. He's playing the solo, but instead our drums are a little bit too loud. So might be something to look at. And then let's see. Palisade says that never happens to me, Mark. That's awesome. Okay, cool. So the other thing was there overall in the mix, I feel like there's a little bit of low mid mud. So just some, you know, kind of murkiness happening, 300, 240-ish. Some of that stuff. The vocal also feels a little dark to me compared to the guitars specifically. So it does feel like a dark vocal anyway, but then the guitars have a mid-range brightness that brings them forward. They're wider, they're a little bit louder. And if we were thinking in terms of like, here's the sides, then my voice is the singer, the guitars are again out in front of the vocal there. So just that might be okay, and that's what you want to go for. But both the volume difference and the tone difference make the vocal feel recessed. So The vocal thing, I do think it could use some more presence. I would try cleaning up the low mids in it first, and then if you felt like it still needed some top, I think a Pultec, pick one, any plugin manufacturer or whatever. The 4K boost can be really nice for that on the on like a MEQ, and then if that doesn't do what you like, 10K is great for opening up the top with a broad, you know, going to like six or something like that on the bandwidth. And then 1073, a little bit of 4K on the mid-range, and playing with that in relation to the top, which is a 12 kilohertz shelf, I believe, on most of them. Should be on all of them. Those are the things that I would, if I had that vocal on a track on, you know, in front of me, those are the things that I would go to try and, like, bring some life out of it and liven it up a little bit. So hope that helps. And your mileage may vary, as with all things. I'm not a professional doctor. Just play one on YouTube or something. All right. Cool. Great. So moving on to the next one. Thank you for submitting that. Super cool to listen to, and I think you did a great job on it, and it's definitely on the way. That's cool. You said it's an original, too. That's freaking awesome. Is that you singing, Keith? Because great voice. Great playing, great voice, great song. It's all good. Okay. Smoking Fudo. I'm looking for your song. D-Pen, you're coming soon. Smoking Fudo, I know that you put one in your... Wasting Away, that's it. Okay, here we go. Wasting Away. My search appears to not be working. Wasting. Somebody asked what I did for speakers on the Atmos thing. I think that was you smoking. Is it Wasting Away? Away? Smoking, I can't find your song. Can you go in there and make sure it's still on for me? It's possible it expired. But I will listen to it. Just you might have to put it back in. Yeah, we'll take a quick nerd break. I'll tell you guys about the Atmos thing. So I've got, as my left, right, I have key threes. Those are my stereo speakers that I'm completely in love with and did not want to replace. Also, I could not buy key threes for all of the speakers because of many reasons that would ruin my life. So instead I got, Focal Shape 65s around me. They also have passive radiators on the sides, like the keys. And, I heard some good things about them and thought I'd give them a shot. So it was, an affordable option that was gonna sound great. And, had a, you know, a lot of people telling me that they felt good dynamically, which is what I was kind of looking for speakers. Now when I like chose the speakers and everything too, this has been an interesting thing for me. I was kind of just thinking like, I don't need the most amazing speakers. Like I just want something. I feel like Atmos is a headphone format and I need something that like, I can hear what's going on in the room, because when I was just mixing in headphones and then I go to other studios with speakers, I felt like if I had been working in that environment, I would have made different decisions. So my thought was, I just need some speakers that like are going to give me the sensation of actual space. And then I can see how that's interacting with all of the binaural stuff that's going on, make my adjustments and be happy. What I found is that I'm super happy with these speakers and it all sounds amazing. And that was a pleasant surprise because I didn't know that that was going to happen in the beginning. I've got, this is a 914 system. It's key threes in the front, and then Focals, center, wides, sides, rears, and then four up top. And all of that is coming from a Trinov Demon 14. They did like another channel upgrade to get me up to the 14 for the 914. And it sounds amazing. It literally, like, I'm completely blown away that this room sounds as good as it does. I wasn't expecting that. My sub is a JBL LSR 4362, I think. I think that's the model number. I got it like 10 years ago. It's been sitting in a closet because I'm not a big fan of subwoofers. Needing an LFE channel, though. So I pulled this thing out, and it had the same specs as a much more expensive sub. And I already owned it, so I plugged that in. It sounds amazing. the Chernov is doing a lot to make things sound great. So very happy there. And I'm like doing a whole video on this, so I'll put that out at some point. And it was like every step through the process as I was tearing apart the room and freaking out and making my house a mess and all that. And yeah, big shout out to my dad who helped me out with all of this stuff. He's an actual engineer and, he helped me place everything and he got down to like tenths of an inch, even smaller than that in some cases. Very, very cool. So, okay. Let's see. Smoking Fudo, did you get your song in there? Let me know. Oh, he said, you removed it. Okay. Well, if you post your song again, Smoking, I will get to it. Okay. Let's go to D-Pen. I'll stop yapping about my stupid speakers and listen to your song. Here we go. D-Pen. Someday, Rev 6. Here we go. Yes, Juan, we'll get to yours as well.
We were once two souls intertwined. Our love was pure. Our love was kind. Life took us on a separate road. And we were first to let to go. Someday, somehow, we'll be together again. Our paths may have diverged, but our love will never end.
D-Pen, I'm just going to comment on something here. First of all, sounds super cool. We'll talk about it, the overall, in a second, but I want to point this out while I'm here because it's something to think about. The vocal verb that you have on here with the super long decay that's giving it that awesome ambience and that super cool dreamy feel, it's great. It feels to me like it's stealing a little bit of intelligibility, and this would be a great case for putting a sidechain compressor after the reverb. So this is assuming that your reverb is set up on an aux return and not as an insert on the track. If it's set up that way, you're sending out to the verb that's coming on an aux return and all that. You could put a compressor after it, sidechain it. You could even use the same feed that's going to the vocal for your sidechain, and then get it so that the compressor, sorry, you would want this compressor to be before the reverb or even after the reverb, and just have it duck the reverb. Sorry, put it after the reverb. It'll duck the reverb when the vocal's actually happening and add a little bit more clarity. So just wanted to point that out while I was having the thought. Here we go.
Somehow we'll be together again. Our paths may have diverged, but our love will never end. The love we had, it never died. And deep down we won't know it's still alive. I pray the faith will bring us back.
Okay, awesome. Deep End. Sounds super cool. The production's amazing on this. Very cool. I'm getting like Weekend vibes from it. And yeah, really great vocal. Thing sounds awesome. Great. Yeah, so the reverb comment that I had from before, just like doing some side chaining to get the reverb to duck while the vocals come in, will add some clarity to it. Overall, the main thing that's going on here to me is that everything feels loud. And because of that, nothing feels loud. So contrast is huge in there. And I feel like there's a lot of compression, either like parallel compression or something exciting the mix, almost like what God Particle does if it's pushed too far. And it's just like, it just feels very loud. Lots of top end, lots of excitement in the upper mids. Nothing is necessarily harsh to me, but everything is bright and all in my face, which isn't a bad thing, but it also feels like a pensive track to me that's a little bit more dreamy. So it's, I feel like some of those elements should be a little bit darker, just to, again, like kind of put the spotlight, like this, if we're talking about like stages and spotlights and like who's supposed to be the focus of the attention and all that stuff, I feel like all of the lights are on the stage right now. And it would be nice to like get a little bit more moody, and highlight some individual things. So, there is not just a high pass filter, but there's also a low pass filter that's very handy for this kind of thing. Like just making some room in the top end so that the thing that you think should be bright can feel bright because something else feels dark. So you can't have close without something far. You can't have loud without something quiet. Basically, I just feel like this mix could use a little bit more contrast, but also it sounds really, really cool. I just think it's a little fatiguing by the time you get to the end of it. But you're so like, to me, and in terms of like how I would hear this in my head, you're so, so very close on it. And it sounds awesome. I don't hear any, you're talking in the comments about how Tom's helped you out with some other things from revision one to this revision six, with the low end, like it's gotten some clarity. You got the vocal out front. And yeah, like it sounds like you've had some good progress on this, which is great. And I think like you're super close, and this is a really, really great sound and production and mix. So awesome. But yeah, just try to find some more contrast between things. And again, do a save as. You could always come back to this version, but listen through it. And if you had like, you know, your list of tracks and you just said like, let me assign an important or a number from 1 to 4, you know, 1 being the most important or something to each of these guys, put down your importance numbers and then listen to the mix and see like, does the mix match up with what my perception of the importance of each element is? And if not, what can I do to make that come to life or whatever, or make that be a true thing? Or maybe you love the bright, you know, very in your face and, you want it to be a little bit exhausting by the end, which is totally cool too. But yeah, that's like what I would look at, is just trying to get some contrast between those parts. Hope that helps. Cool. There's good comments in the chat as well. So they're saying things like drums could use a little more volume, etc. Paul said, I have to do a video, a studio or a studio tour video. Absolutely. Yeah, we'll do that for sure. I'm one of these. So I'm almost done with the install. I have to clean up some wires and stuff like that. That's just making my OCD go a little crazy, but I'm very, very close. And also, I have to clean all the stuff out of the hallway from outside of the room because it's gotten crazy. So, okay. Cool. Let's see what else we got here. Jealousy from Juan. Let's do it. Here we go. Jealousy. So, Jealousy, this song has been used on Puremix a bunch. It was recorded at a masterclass we did at MSR with Fab DuPont and Mick Guzowski. That was a super, super fun one. Mick tracked the song at MSR Studios, which unfortunately is now defunct. It was in Times Square and got turned into condos or something. Very not as cool. And then it was mixed by Fab the next day. It was really, really fun. The band is Brandy and the Alexanders. I've used this song a lot on the plugin videos and all that. It's super cool. So let's check it out. Here we go.
Jealousy shows me. me things I don't want to see. Jealousy holds me back from who I'm meant to be.
That is a freaking vocal, man. God, she's so good. I've heard that song like 400 times, and man, one, I've heard that song like 400 times, and that's one of the most fun times I've ever heard it. I have some things, some comments about the mix, but most importantly, that was a lot of fun. And again, I've heard this song about 400 times. I was there when it was tracked. I was there when it was mixed originally. I was there when we shot the video of it being mixed again. I was there for every plugin video where I've used this song on there, and I've heard it again like 400 times. That was one of the most fun listens I've had of the song for sure. Great job on the energy of it and the excitement of it. You did a lot of things. Again, I know this multi-track like the back of my hand. You did a lot of things on the transitions from section to section. You put some soul into this thing, and a whole lot of, like, there's a whole lot of feeling here. So very, very cool. Great job. That's the most important thing. I've got little things to gripe about. Little things to gripe about. But it was a really fun mix. Okay. Going back. Great job. Singer, man. It was Paul. The singer is Brandy Alexander. The name of the band is Brandy and the Alexanders. She's out of New York City. She's amazing. Absolutely amazing singer. And I believe that she does session work. And I think that she does some remote session stuff too. I'm not positive, but I would look for her online if you're ever looking for a singer for your track, because she's great. Yeah, very cool. All right. Whew. Cool. Jaw Warrior next, question mark? Yeah, I think that we might be there, Jaw Warrior. But okay, comments. So this vocal, I use this one on the plugin show all the time because that vocal is super unruly in the beginning. Also, guys, for anybody who wants to mix this, just look up Jealousy on Puremix on the site. You can download the multi-tracks, I believe, from Fab's mixing session of this song. But yeah, you can download the mixing track or the multi-track and have a go of it yourself. It's the full length, just like what you heard here. So the reason I use this on the plugin show, the first half of that vocal, this was done in a couple takes. Like it was all live and it happened very, very quickly. If memory serves, what happened was Mick was still getting tones while they were doing this take, and he hadn't dialed in Brandy's vocal compression yet. I think he had an LA-2A on her. And he hadn't, like, just tweaked it yet to catch the craziness of... She's very powerful, as you can hear. In the beginning of it, it's very peaky. So he, somewhere around, like, verse 2 or before verse 2, he, like, turned around and adjusted the threshold on it. And then it's, like, smooth and butter for the rest of the song, and the vocals well-treated and all that stuff. The beginning of it is super transient, and it's hard to deal with, and you dealt with the super peak very well. One thing I noticed that happened in the beginning, though, is that the vocal felt a little overcompressed to me, which I totally get because that was a super transient vocal. A way around it would be parallel compression, and then you would have to automate because that vocal changes as, you know, Mick turned around to adjust the LA-2A. You would have to automate all of it, obviously, to kind of deal with that. So it feels a little overcompressed to me in the beginning. It felt better as it went along, and I felt like the vocal balance got better by the last chorus for sure. And again, because I know the multi-track, I know it's because, like, the vocal, the quality of the, you know, of what Mick was doing improved by the end of the song, but also what you were doing improved to me by the end of the song, too. The long reverb that you have on Brandy, to me, it's very bright, and it sounds, you know, if I was thinking period piece for this, I'm thinking, like, the things that come to mind on this song are, like, plate reverb, right? Like, dark plate reverb, something vibey, kind of nasty and textured and gritty. And so I think, like, plate, dirty plate, that kind of thing. You have, like, a very bright, modern-sounding reverb on here with a very, very long tail. And I like that you're using that to fill in holes in the groove. But as we go into, say, like, the chorus, where you do such a good job of highlighting all the subdivisions that are happening in the drums with the hi-hat and everything, I feel like the long verb is stealing away some of the groove that's happening there. So either I would darken that reverb, change that reverb, or shorten that reverb, or automate the length of that reverb from section to section, just to leave some breathing room for the groove and do something that's more in time with the rest of the band. What I would imagine that being like with that kind of verb going on, it's like, it's almost like if you had a band that's like playing a tight groove and then you just got one guitar player, like, I don't, if you guys know Scary Pockets, for example, like if you had Scary Pockets playing and then you just got one guitar player who's like, just like strumming chords open or whatever, like you got like a tight funk thing happening and then the guitar player is just like not muting in between strums, just like strumming the chords or whatever, totally like smearing the pocket, I guess would be a good way to say it. So I would consider like bringing that reverb back or shortening the tail or darkening it in the chorus is doing something to just kind of give us a break from it too. By the time that we got to the bridge, I was kind of tired of hearing the long tail on that verb. So yeah, as you've done like automation from section to section and all that, use that to create a scene change. You know, I think that'd be cool. And then the side stick snare reverb also is a very bright and long and forward reverb. And the two of them going side by side almost sounds like double S-ing going on. So same thing. Like, I would maybe use a different color of reverb, shorten the tail. I do like that you, like, you did some automation or you separated those side sticks to actually do something fun with them. That was awesome. But yeah, like, the two long reverbs going, I felt like were contrasting and conflicting with each other. I love the ghost notes that you pulled out on the choruses. That being said, I feel like there was a little bit too much 4K in there, either on the hi-hat or the snare or both. And it could be dialed back just a hair. They also both got in front of the vocal, and we had great sounding drums, great sounding pocket, slightly more important than the vocal. Again, like, Brandy's just slaying it through that whole thing. So, like, we got to keep her as a star or whatever. Sometimes pulling her back and makes the listener lean in and add some of that energy that you have. That's a lot of the reason I think that this was a fun listen, was like, she wasn't so on top of the mix that it was like, I get it, stop yelling at me, girl. Like, she's sitting behind the drums and all of that, which, like, it makes you lean in and it's compelling and she feels like she's fighting against the band and all that. So I feel like you did a good job there, but in moments I felt like the hi-hat and the snare were more important than the vocal, and that wasn't really the case. So without losing the energy of what you did, see if you could adjust that. It might just be an EQ thing. There you go. And that's, you know, again, my opinion, of course. I thought you did a good job on the background vocals. There wasn't anything super special about them, but they felt like they fit in the mix well. There might have been a little bit of widening stuff that I wasn't totally digging, because at first I was like, I think I love those backgrounds. And then I was like, they might be a little phasey, but I think overall they're pretty good. I thought the balance of them was really good, at the very least of it. And again, that was just a fun, fun listen. So great job. Very cool. Awesome. Martin says, now the rant part. Exactly. You got to start it off nice, and then you do the rant. Martin knows my tricks. Okay. All right. Let me see. Guys, I think I've gotten to the end of all of the mixes. I don't have anything else on my list that I saw from the comments. So we are going to, if I missed anybody, tell me your username and the name of the song in the chat comments. And otherwise, I'm going to pull up a mix from a visitor. So this is not from a Puremix member. This is from Jaw Warrior, who has been hanging out here patiently the whole time and asked if I would listen to his song. Let's do it this one time, shall we? It's cool of somebody to pop in. So I am looking in my email, and I see it. Here we go. All right. The song is Tara Lee. Or the name of the band is Tara Lee, and the song is Space in Hell, I think. Okay. All right, let's see if this works. I've never played something out of Dropbox for the stream before, but I think we're good. So here we go. This is from our guest, Jaw Warrior. Thanks for joining in. Here we go.
You feel like to see. So right, I
Yeah, this is great. Awesome, man. Thank you so much for like coming and hanging out on the stream and everything without, you know, you not even being a Puremix member and all that. And just super cool that you're here. And also, we'd love to have you in the Mix Tank community because this is awesome. Very cool. So let's chat about it. One funny thing. John Hawk says, reminds me of a pre-pregnancy Rihanna. Nice. Okay. Awesome. I don't know why I found that funny. Okay. So first thing, the beat, the production, everything sounds really great on this. Let us know, what your role is in this whole thing. Are you just the mixing engineer, the producer, the singer, the whole thing? Let us know. Kaiser on the radio says clean vocal, which mic? Yeah, very cool. Keith says good stuff. Yeah. Awesome job, Josh. So, okay, things that I got. Lots of energy throughout. It's a fun listen. Very, very cool. The first verse, I feel like the vocal is over de-essed at times. I think that throughout the song, there's a couple points where it feels like the de-esser is just hitting a little too hard. And then there's other times where the vocal feels great. So it feels like the de-esser isn't working too hard. That means you're probably going to have to automate the de-esser. So I would just do a pass where you listen very intently for, are any S's getting swallowed up? If you hear one that gets swallowed, automate the threshold on your de-esser and let it breathe. Let that one get through. Otherwise, you end up with spots where it's too much S-ing removed and then other spots where it's great. So check that out. I felt like the vocal was a little cloudy in the low mids, so like 160 up to 200. Could even be going up as high as 300, just kind of depended on where she was in her range. I heard some murkiness just happening down in that range though. That can also happen from overcompression. So just watch, make sure that if you're compressing, like you could try releasing the attack a little bit. If you feel that it's not an EQ thing or EQ is not helping you out, it could just be the compressor's biting too much. Slow down the attack, let the vocal breathe a little bit more. But overall, the vocal balance feels pretty good to me. It doesn't necessarily feel way too overcompressed, especially for the style. So I'd see if you can clean it up with EQ. If not, look at your compression. Same thing in the chorus on the vocal. The snaps in the pre-chorus were a hair too crisp for me at spots. That I feel like the snaps could pull back a little bit, especially because when the chorus dropped, the snare didn't have the same snap as the pre-chorus snaps. It didn't have the same like harsh mid-range thing that was going on there. So I think you got to chill the snaps out a little bit. You could let those be in the background more. Right now they're in front of the vocal. I think that you could have that be a distant element, not so distant that we lose the groove, because I think that some of that crispness is like keeping the backbeat and keeps the flow moving. If it was totally washed out and in the back, the song would feel very, very lethargic at that point. So play with that. But I think it'd come back a little bit. That would highlight the vocal a little bit more. In the chorus, I thought the vocals could use some more shine, some more top end. And then my next thing was a question for you to think about. Where should this vocal be in relation, thinking depth-wise, so front to back, right? So this is close, this is far. Let's say that the snare drum is right here. In your mind, should the vocal be in front of the snare drum or should it be behind the snare drum? Right now for me, the vocal is a little bit behind the snare drum. If they had some more shine and the volume was a little bit louder, they would be sitting on top of the snare drum. It's just another way to think about your mix. I'm guessing you haven't seen Mix Tank before, but I talk all the time about front to back depth. And that's one of the most important things to me in mixing is just front to back depth. That's what tells you how loud or bright or dark or something, you know, an element of the mix should be. So where should the vocal be? Should it be on top of the mix? Should it be slightly behind? That's just something for you to think about as you're going through and doing the mixing on it. When we get to out of chorus one into verse two, the snare, it's the same snare, so we're not going to a snap or anything. It's the same snare from chorus one to verse two. The snare was the same level. I felt like the snare could have dropped down a little bit and given us a little bit of breather from all the energy of the chorus. Where with it just sitting static like that, it felt like the snare was way outside of the mix because all of the chorus elements had gone away and you just were left with the snare kind of sitting up there. Not completely naked, of course, there was other stuff, but it was the same level and I felt like for dynamics, you could come down a little bit. Other than that, great freaking vocal effects. The production's awesome. You said in the chat you're the producer of this track, and this is your artist that you're rolling out. Best of luck to you guys with this, because there's a lot of talent on that team. That's going to be awesome, man. Let everybody know the name of the artist and like where we should watch for if you want to. Drop it in the chat. Let us know when it's going to be out and everything. So that was super cool. And thanks for joining. Thanks for watching. Thanks for sitting through all the other mixes until I got to yours, too. Very cool. Awesome. Guys, tell Jao to come join our cult. If we can call it a cult. I don't think I can call it a cult. I might get yelled at for that. All right. Awesome. Jao said the vocal was recorded on a Mojave 301 FET mic. That's an amazing microphone. Very cool. Guys, I think that wraps it up for today. Thank you so much to everybody for submitting your mixes. I hope that my feedback was helpful. Remember, like a lot of it's, you know, personal insight and opinion. There are a lot of great comments in the chat, too. So make sure that if you had a mix on here, watch out in the chat for tips from everybody else as well. And we will be back on Monday with another episode of the Great Big Plugin Show. If things go as planned, which there's a lot of moving parts, it's going to be an amazing one. That said, there's a lot of amazing parts. So if it doesn't happen next Monday, it'll happen a different Monday and we'll do a different plugin on Monday. But anyway, tune in Monday, 2:30 p.m. Eastern next Monday for another episode of the Great Big Plugin Show. And then 2 weeks, we'll be back here with another Mixed Tank Live. So thank you everybody for tuning in. And yeah, thanks for all your submissions and everything. All right, we will see you next time. Bye.